Behind the Beats with Jess Bowen and Bowie Jane. Hello, it's Bowie Jane here with Jess Bowen for Babes Behind the Beats, and it is our first proper episode back for 2021. Welcome, everyone.
I cannot believe it. It feels like it's been forever since we've chatted or like done a chinwag. So I'm like, how do we do this again? What do we do?
I know. And we're both in different cities because of lockdown. So we're both in our respective closets, which is lovely.
I in a new closet now that I've been forced back into to do this chinwag.
Actually, speaking of closets, Jess, you're well and truly out of the closet, aren't you?
Oh, yeah. Very, very much so. And I don't know if you saw recently, but I just got engaged too.
Yeah. Then she's well and truly out.
Well and truly out. Now getting married to my fiance. That's crazy. I get to say fiance now.
You're such a lady.
I'm such a lady. But yeah, that is the big news that I have for 2021. Obviously, I think we were all excited to kind of move into a new year, hoping that 2020 we could put behind us and really hoping for the best in 2021. And I really had a great start. I mean, 2021 started out with me getting proposed to by my best friend. So that's a pretty good start, I'd say.
Yeah. And the lead up to this, because it was all, obviously it was a secret. And so Jess and I were lining up times to record. And then I was getting texts from Lauren going, oh, no, you can't, because I'm proposing that day. And I'm like, oh, shit. Okay, cool. We'll move it around. And then Jess is continuously trying to organize things on that day, right?
Yeah. Okay. I guess I can just kind of tell the story. I'll try to keep it as condensed as possible and as interesting to other people. But basically, she had planned this trip for us to go stay at the same Airbnb that we stayed at last year, this time last year. So she came to visit me January 6th through 8th of 2020. And that was technically our second date. She like flew to Arizona for our second date. And we stayed in this Airbnb in Old Town Scottsdale and did a bunch of different things. So this year, I find out the night before, she goes, all right, your last surprise, because she told me I had one more Christmas present. She goes, your last surprise is we're going on a trip. You have to pack your bags for two nights. So I don't know where we're going. But long story short, next thing I know, we end up at this Airbnb. And I was like, oh my God, this is so cute. This is exactly where we stayed last year. And so we're just doing all these things that we did from last year to just kind of reminisce and celebrate. One of which was climbing Camelback Mountain, which is this very, very popular hike here in Arizona, which I need to take you to, Bowie, because I feel like you would love it. The view at the top is just insane. But she took me there. And mind you, I woke up crazy hungover that morning. It was a Thursday. The night before, like I said, we're celebrating. This is kind of like our year anniversary celebration. So I drank a little too much, I guess, and woke up hungover. I've always joked around with her about like putting a ring on it and proposing. I'll be like, babe, when are you going to put a ring on it? Or like, babe, like, how come you haven't proposed yet? Like just saying things like that. I always did that to her. So this morning, this particular morning, I was hungover and I was telling her like, babe, I don't know if I can do the hike today. She's like, you have to do the hike. And I was like, are you going to propose? And she's like, what? What are you talking? No, like blows me off completely.
But you didn't actually think she was going to propose. That was just a running joke, right?
That was just the running joke. But I just decided to say it because she was like forcing me to go on this hike. So I guess somewhere in my subconscious, I must have been like, maybe thought, I don't know. But honestly, like swear to you, I had no idea. I just always joke with her.
And the reason she couldn't move the date or anything is because and I knew this was going on too. Lauren had organized a photographer to be waiting in the bushes.
Yeah.
But so she had all this stuff organized and she'd organized for everyone to be waiting and all this kind of stuff. And then you're there going, I'm hungover. I can't go.
Literally like me, I would have killed if the roles were reversed, I would have like killed me. Cause like how annoying of me to just be like, I'm hungover. I don't want to do this hike. She's like, you're going on the hike. And so at one point too, I said, babe, you don't have to propose today since I'm hungover. It's okay. You're off the hook for today since I'm hungover. But totally joking. Long story short, of course, I didn't get off the hook. So we're hiking. We get to the top of the mountain and, you know, we're just kind of, I noticed a photographer there. I did. I'm not going to lie. I did notice this photographer because he obviously has this nice big old camera. And I just thought he was taking nature photos. I really did. I honestly thought he was just taking pictures at the top of this mountain because people do that. It's that type of place. And so we're just kind of sitting around, you know, on the rocks, taking pictures with each other. And I'm like, all right, we should, you know, we really need to head down because because it's going to take us another hour to get down this mountain and the sun's about to set. She's like, well, hold on. Just like, let's just go over here and take more pictures. So we go over to this other side and she keeps like trying to force me to drink water. So this is like the third time now that she goes, babe, like you should hydrate. And I said, babe, I don't need water. I've been drinking water. I don't need it. She's like, you really need this. You're hungover. You need to hydrate. I'm worried about you. So I finally like reluctantly take this water bottle and I try drinking it and nothing comes out. So then my first thought is, I'm like, well, why would you give me an empty water bottle, babe? So I'm like getting mad at her, kind of. Like, you're telling me to drink water, but you give me an empty water bottle. Anyway, she's like, it's empty? Well, what could be in there? So then I'm like, what do you mean what could be in here? Nothing's in here. So I open the thing. I'm opening this water bottle and I see rose petals. And so I kind of turn it over and I start dumping the rose petals into my hand. And then out comes the ring, which again falls to the ground.
Oh my God. Luckily didn't fall off the edge.
Luckily didn't fall off the mountain, which she thought, actually, she said that thought had crossed her mind. And I was like, well, then thank God we weren't like on another edge of this mountain. But anyways, it falls out. It falls to the ground and she gets down on her knee when it falls. And then that's when it finally clicks and hits me.
Oh,
and I honestly blacked out. She was saying all these beautiful things, which thank God she had her phone memo running, like her voice memo thing. Yes, because I blacked out and she said she did too. So it'll be funny to actually, we still haven't listened back to it. I'll have to listen back and see exactly what she said. But it was just all these lovely things, obviously, about how she wants to spend her life with me and how she, you know, actually the first, I think the way she started it was, now you know you're never going to get off the hook for being hungover ever. Then, yeah, I mean, it was like perfect. I really wasn't expecting it. And then the photographer was there and took all these photos. And then it turned into this whole engagement photo shoot at the top of the mountain, which I was not expecting that.
Oh my God. She'd already spoken to your parents, right?
She did, yeah. So that was the other nice thing. And another nice surprise was, as we're going down the mountain, I kept asking her questions. I was like, did you tell people? Like, did you tell my parents? Did you tell my brother? Did you tell my sister-in-law? And she was like, no, I figured we could tell them together. And so I was like, oh my God. I was like, oh my God. I have so many phone calls to make when we get down the mountain and everyone's going to be like, what? But little did I know, obviously, when we got down there, then they were waiting with Pepe with like signs and they were like recording and like cheering and they brought champagne and stuff like that. So it was really perfect.
So she'd already spoken to your parents and said, can I have her hand?
Basically, she had like asked for permission in the sense of like, I guess she brought the ring in and asked my mom like, hey, do you want to see the last gift that I'm going to give Jess? And then brought it in to show her. And of course, then my mom was like, oh my God. And then Lauren was like, you know, will you have me and your family? And then my mom was like, of course.
Oh,
and then she called my dad and she goes, dad, come look at this ring. And then I guess my mom was also like, no, wait, go away. Jess is going to get suspicious. Get out of here. Oh. So he could only look for like a second, but was like super excited.
That's so good. That was a good way for her to break it to your mom, actually.
Yeah, it was really perfect. My mom told me she loved it. And I mean, the whole thing was so perfectly done. I just feel so bad for being hungover, because I'm like, that would be what I do, is like get too drunk the night before the day that I'm going to get proposed to.
Hey, and at like, least you turned up. Thank God. I wouldn't have been able to get up. That would have been the problem.
Yeah, I know. I was like in bed literally up until we had to start hiking. So we started the hike at 3 p.m. and I didn't get out of bed until 2:45.
Oh my God.
She kept telling me too. Obviously, she was trying to get me to like put makeup on, because she was like, well, we're going to be taking engagement photos, but couldn't tell me that. So she just kept saying like, babe, I want to take photos at the top of the mountain. So like, I'm putting makeup on. She's like sitting in the bathroom, curling her hair, putting makeup on. And how did I not know? You know what I mean? Like, why would she curl her hair to go hike Camelback Mountain?
And also, for anyone who hasn't seen the photos, have a look at our Instagram, Babes Behind the Beats, because we've put some photos of that actual moment on, and it's really cool. And you'll notice that Jess has lovely nails in that photo. Jess doesn't usually really go to much trouble with her nails. So how on earth did she get that to happen?
Well, this is another thing. So because Lauren had already told my mom and my mom was in on it, she, like 2 days before we did this hike, starts telling me and Lauren, like, we need to do our nails. And I'm like, mom, I don't need a manicure. Like, I just do pedicures. I'm just going to do my toenails. And she's like, nope, you got to do your nails too. Like, forces me to get my actual nails done.
Red too.
And also, I will say, I never get this color on my actual nails. Like on my toenails, maybe, but on my fingernails, I'll go for like a nude, you know, I'm just not like very like a bright red nails girl. And so But they were in on it. My mom was in on it. So I'm happy, though, because I would have hated if he was sitting there. We did a lot of pictures with my hands. So
yeah, and the ring's amazing. It's super sparkly.
Very sparkly. Yeah.
Where's the wedding going to be? In which city, do you think?
Well, goodness. Who knows? Who knows? We're not in a rush. We knew that we wanted to get married. Like, I feel like at our age, we're in our 30s and we have had past relationships and, you know, we know what works and what doesn't work. And so I feel like from the very beginning of her and I getting together, we already knew we wanted, it was just such a good match. And we always said that with each other. We're like, I've never had such a healthy relationship as far as just feeling like complete and mutual respect for one another and like having the best communication. And like, we rarely fight. And if we do fight, it doesn't last long because we're so good at like just talking to each other. And
yeah,
I just
that's
have
important,
like,
isn't it?
It's so important. And I just kind of lacked that kind of, there was just something that didn't work in the past relationship. So when you get to this age and you find it, it's even though we've only been together for a year, and especially because there was COVID this whole last year. So we spent every day together for a whole year. It kind of makes you feel like you were together for like a few years, you know?
Yeah.
In the best way, though. In the best way of being like, we spend all this time together and like, I know you're the one for me. So yeah, I really wasn't expecting to get proposed to, but it was perfect.
Oh, it's so exciting. Well, we can't wait for the wedding. It's going to be a massive party. And
it is going to be a big party. Yeah. We will see. It depends on how COVID is doing.
Yeah, I know, right? God. Well, so there we go. That's our summary of the start of this year. It's been an exciting one already. And then today we have a French guitarist on, singer-songwriter as well, Laura Cox.
Yeah, I'm excited to chat with her. I've been watching some of her videos on Instagram and this girl shreds.
Yeah, and the interesting thing is she does rock and she was saying like there isn't a lot of rock and people don't grow up on rock in France.
Yeah.
So did you notice that when you were there or touring at all? I mean, you guys are more pop, but you're a rock kind of drummer, it feels like.
Yeah, I don't know. I've been to Paris a handful of times with the artists that I play with. And then with the Somerset, obviously, we were there a few times as well. And I don't know. I didn't notice that there wasn't a huge rock scene there. But that is something that's very interesting to me to hear more about because I feel like rock would be big everywhere, right?
Yeah, you
just
think
don't feel
so.
Like, yeah, so I'm interested to hear why she says that.
Yeah, I think suggesting that the style of rock is different. So it's not so much your AC/DC style, which is how like Australians have really grown up on that particular style. So it'd be interesting to hear what she says further about that. Yeah, she's had an interesting life. So yeah, we're going to have her up next. Well, Jess, we are finally here with very special guest Laura Cox, who is a guitarist and has her own band, the Laura Cox Band. I am all the way from Europe. That's right, guys. We've got someone from Europe on. Welcome, Laura, whose birthday it is in 20 minutes.
20 minutes.
Don't forget that.
Yeah, thank you for having me. I'm so, so happy to be joining the party with you, the birthday party.
Yeah, thank you for letting us like celebrate your birthday with you, too, on this podcast. We're so excited.
it's the first time I'm doing this.
Where are you exactly located for our Europe friends?
Yeah, I'm near Paris.
Ah, nice.
Here the lockdown is crazy because we can't go out anymore and it's bad. All the gigs have been cancelled, so we have to wait for a few months to play again, but otherwise everything is okay.
Heading into winter, everything's good. So it seems Europe's a little ahead of us with all the lockdowns. So you're about 3 weeks ahead. We've just gone into another lockdown here. So our second one in Los Angeles. So my cousins are in Paris. Shout out to Katerina and Carolyn. Hello, hello. They grew up in Monaco. Where did you grow up?
I grew up near Paris. I never left this area. I wish I could have lived in another country because France isn't very rock and roll. Rock and roll isn't popular here in France. But yeah, I've always been near Paris.
And your music is rock and roll. You are a rock guitarist, right?
Yes, yes. I play electric guitar in a rock band. All the music I'm listening to is American or English or Australian music.
Your dad's from, is he British?
Yeah, my dad is from England, but he never taught me how to speak English. I learned in school and with TV shows, thanks to Grey's Anatomy and Charmed. And so, yeah, I should be able to speak English like a real English person, but no, I'm French. So.
Well, you sound great, so don't worry. And the accent, okay. You have an amazing French accent, which I absolutely love. So cool.
That's what I was thinking. I love your accent.
As long as we understand each other, it's okay.
Exactly. We're all good there. And also, I love Grey's Anatomy, so I love that that's what you were watching to pick up learning English, because that's amazing.
Yeah.
From your dad being from England, was that a big influence on the music that you listened to? Because you said you're rock and roll, and obviously some of the most iconic British rock bands that came out of England were rock bands, mm-hmm. and they were British. So was that a lot of your influence in music?
Yeah, I think so, definitely. If dad was French, I think I wouldn't be playing guitar. I don't really know. All I know is that since I was a child, he made me listen to great rock and roll music and country music like Johnny Cash, Willie Nelson, Dire Straits, AC/DC. In France, we don't have that musical culture. So I'm really thankful for that. Yeah.
Where in the UK is your dad from?
I think he's born near Bedford. Do you know Bedford?
Bedford, yeah.
Yeah, but yeah, I don't really know much about it. I've always lived in France. My mother is French. I've never lived anywhere else. With my band, we got to play in different countries, but I really never left France.
And the French music scene is really different, only because when I've been there, I'm like, wow, I don't know any of the songs on the radio. There is a little bit of maybe the American pop, but in Australia we play American pop.
Yeah, like Taylor Swift.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly. Yeah. Okay. France seems to be really individual, like they've got their own market. Was that your experience as well?
France is really attached to French language, so they're doing everything they can to put French music on the radio and people who speak in French. So that's not my case. With my band, I speak English, so it's hard to be played on the radio in France.
Wow.
But other than that, yeah, we have American pop music and English pop music. It's not really rock and roll, unfortunately.
But you can obviously speak French, so do you record your songs in French and in English so that you can get that airplay, or you're not interested in doing that?
No, I'm not even thinking about it. I just want to play the music I love, and I just grew up listening to English and American songs. It's weird, but it's natural for me to write songs in English, because I think rock and roll isn't meant to be played and sung in French. It sounds weird. in French, it's really hard to write music. We already tried that in my band, and I wasn't able to do that. So my best friend, who's also the other guitarist in the band, he's better than me at writing music in French. Now, I don't know. It's not the same for me. Rock and roll has to be in English.
Yeah. And so, speaking of rock and roll, then, who are your biggest influences? If you could name maybe like top three that you like really take from, who really influenced like your style and loving rock and roll?
When I started guitar, my favorite guitar player was Slash from the Guns N' Roses. And I learned a lot just trying to play his solos and everything. Now I'm listening to more modern and new music, but they're not really so famous. Maybe you know them, but there are two guitarists that I'm listening at the moment. They are Jared James Nichols. He's an American blues rock guitarist, and Tyler Bryant, who opened for AC/DC and the Guns N' Roses. And they are two young guitarists that are really, really great, and they're really talented. And if I had to choose a singer, maybe you know her, I would choose Lizzie Hale from Hailstorm.
Hailstorm.
She's my favorite singer. I love her voice. She has the most powerful voice, she's so talented. So that's the singer I would choose. Yeah.
So what happened for you then? Obviously, you do both guitar and singing, but you got your start with guitar, is that right? Like when you're a kid, what happened for you? Was it guitar or vocals?
No, it was really about the guitar. I started playing guitar 15 years ago because my dad was listening to great rock and roll music. And then I thought, maybe if I wanted to start a band, I should be able to sing. So naturally, I started singing. My thing is really the guitar playing. I'm trying to put the two skills on the same level, but I'm still thinking that I'm more a guitarist than a singer.
Did you start basically just posting videos on YouTube when you started learning guitar? You have a huge following on there, right? Like 400,000 subscribers or something like that.
Yeah, I think so. I haven't looked recently, but yeah, I started uploading videos on YouTube maybe in 2008. And at the time, there weren't many female guitar players uploading classic rock electric guitar covers on YouTube. I think that's why people started following me. So now, yeah, I think I have more than 400,000 followers on YouTube and maybe more than 100 million views.
That's crazy. That's a lot. That's a lot.
But I think that's where I got lucky, because I started early without even thinking about it. I just wanted to share my passion and my videos and get some advice and get some comments about my playing. So yeah, I basically started uploading videos on YouTube 12 years ago, and that's where it all started.
Wow. And was it more covers at the start and now you've gone into the original? Yeah.
Yeah. The time when I started uploading music, it was mostly covers. And now it's a mix of everything. It's covers, original songs, sometimes gear reviews or demos, or it's a mix. Yeah, when I started, it was covers.
And so for people that are wondering, I feel like we get asked this a lot as well, and I'm still not even so sure about this. When you're posting covers on YouTube, are you able to monetize that, or is that something that you can't because it's the rights are owned by obviously whoever... play the song is by?
It depends on the songs, but most of the time I'm not able to monetize the songs because I don't own the rights for the songs. And even for my songs, I'm not able to monetize the video because when I signed the contracts with the record label, I gave away some of the rights. The songs belong to them also. So
yeah.
When you're a musician, I think it's really hard to money. The only way I have to earn money on YouTube is just when I upload music that doesn't belong to anyone, like improvisation or jams or demos or not a real song.
Right.
Yeah.
And then is it that you can run ads on it via YouTube? Is that right?
I don't know how that works, but I just have to know case if I want to monetize the video or not, and then I don't know, YouTube is just taking care of the rest.
It helped obviously to use YouTube as the platform to kind of get you noticed, so even though you weren't necessarily monetizing it, it was like, oh, at least you obviously garnered this huge
exposure.
Following and exposure, so that was kind of the benefit in doing it, right? I guess that would be
because for me, YouTube isn't about money. I don't really earn money via YouTube. Is just a good way to, I don't know, promote my music or just share music with people. I started via YouTube 12 years ago, and I feel like I have a lot of people waiting for me to upload music every month, so trying to do my best to please them. But I think that there were some times where I haven't uploaded anything for maybe 6 months or a year, and I thought, maybe people are just going to be bored and they're just going to unsubscribe, but no, they're still here, so I'm really thankful about that.
Are you trying to upload monthly or weekly? Have you found your sweet spot? I know it's a lot of time to record and edit and then upload, but if you had a big team around you, what would you think your ultimate upload sort of frequency would be? Like, how often would you upload?
I am always thinking like I don't upload as much as I should because I don't have any strategy. I don't really think about it. I think I'm uploading videos at the best every 2 months and at the worst every year. So no, I should upload more. So, and I try to take advantage of the confinement and the quarantine to upload more. The past years, my main activity was my band. So I stopped uploading videos for a while, but yeah, I should get into it and upload more. I know I should do it. I'm trying to keep it natural, just uploading things whenever I feel like it, and the rest of the time I'm touring. I was touring with my band. Everything was going really well before the coronavirus, so yeah.
Where were you guys touring?
Mostly in France, also in Europe, in Germany, in Spain, in the UK, but mostly in France. Now everything has stopped, and I think think we're going to tour again, maybe in January or February. I can't wait.
Oh, you are touring in January or February?
I hope so. It depends on what the government is going to announce.
Yeah, I was going to be a few shows in Europe as well. Of course, yeah, like everything got canceled.
Yeah, the last time we played some gigs last month, it was good because we could play, but we were playing in front of a seating and masked audience with people just sitting with their mask on.
Oh, yeah.
So it wasn't really rock and roll, but at least the shows weren't canceled. So
that's the whole thing. It's strange now because even here, I don't know if they're doing this there, they're doing these drive-in shows as well where like people sit in their cars. And I just feel like, yeah, for rock and roll, like having people seated, it just really takes away from the vibe of you on stage, right? Because you really like vibe off of the crowd. So if you're just seeing everyone sitting in masks and you can't even see then if they're singing along or rocking out really, it's like, it loses all the energy.
Yeah, but it's still better than not having the show. We can still see that they're happy. We can see in their eyes that they're enjoying the show. But it's not like real rock and roll show.
Are they doing the drive-in things in France?
I don't think so. I've never experienced it. So
interesting.
I've seen it on Facebook, but I don't think they're doing it in France. I've never done that.
How did you get into writing your own music, or have you always been writing your own music? Like, what was the transition?
At first, I was just uploading covers on YouTube, and then I met my best friend, who was also a member of the band, the other guitarist, who's called Mathieu. He told me, yeah, you have to get out and play with real people instead of just uploading your stuff on YouTube. We started writing songs together. So we released two albums. Our first one was in 2017, and the latest was a year ago. We write songs together, the lyrics and guitar parts we were writing together.
Oh, wow, that's really cool. You're in a band with someone who you write with. Obviously, that's not always the case, but sometimes it is the case. I think, Jess, you guys all wrote together, so that was good.
Yeah, I mean, you want to find someone that, like you said, you vibe with, and it needs to be a good fit, and especially if it's someone that you intend on being in a band together with and touring the
world. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Laura. Happy birthday to you.
Yes.
Thank you. I'm drinking beer and it's thank you.
Anyone was wondering why we just sang happy birthday, because it's her birthday. It's midnight now in France.
Paris, yeah.
Now we've got to all have a drink to celebrate. I know you cut you off mid-sentence, but it was very important that we celebrate.
I forgot about it, so thanks a lot.
Well, I'm about to take a shot in your honor, and we know, it's 3 o'clock right now. It's 5 o'clock somewhere, and it's obviously midnight somewhere else, so it's fine.
It's midnight here.
Yes. Well, happy birthday.
There we go. Birthday.
Thank you.
Delicious. That was a bit of fun.
So, Laura, I've been to Europe a few times on tour. I'm wondering, do you have like a favorite show or festival that you've played there that you could tell us about?
Yeah, I think one of my favorite festivals in France, and they have that festival in several countries. It's the Download. We have the Download France, and I know that they have the Download in the UK, in Spain, and then in Australia, I think, and in Spain.
Yeah.
We played at Download France 2 years ago in 2018, and it was on a small stage, but it was one of my favorite gigs because the same weekend, there were the Guns N' Roses, the Foo Fighters, and we were in the backstage with those bands, so it was like a dream come true. And then another festival, my favorite festival, it's a French one. It's called Hellfest, and it's a really big classic rock, hard rock, and metal festival. And we were supposed to play at Hellfest last June, but it was cancelled. So hopefully it will be next June. We'll see. It's supposed to be postponed because of the virus. We'll see how it goes.
Wow. I mean, that sounds incredible. Download Fest is huge, so that's amazing.
Yeah.
And are you getting to hang backstage? Like, so Guns N' Roses are playing, and obviously you're probably separated, but yeah. Did you sort of get to hang with them a bit or not
so much? No, because I didn't even want to. I was backstage and we got to see the helicopters coming with the accent
Rose and Slash, God.
I think. And I just wanted to grab a beer at the bar, and some police officer that told me, no, don't move, the helicopters are coming, just stay put. And it was really a nice memory, and I hope we can have that again in a few months, so we'll see.
And with the festivals, did you get much of a chance to do sound check, like as a guitarist, singer, like what was your sort of setup with it? Probably no sound check or little to none, I imagine.
Yeah. Usually we like to have like an hour and a half sound check to be able to feel comfortable on stage, but it depends on the venues and the festivals. And most of the time we have our sound engineer with us, and she knows what we like and what we, yeah, she knows how we work. Most of the time it's going fast and it's easy, but we like to have really proper sound, like 1.5 hour sound check.
Yeah, to perform really well, you need a really good sound check. But of course, on the fly, you kind of have to, at these festivals, we've talked about this a little bit before with some of the sound engineers that we've had on our podcast. And it's like, sometimes you just got to go on the fly and just hope for the best. But that's why it's important to have your own sound engineer, right? Because they kind of already know what you want. And when you don't get a sound check, they can kind of at least start it somewhere where they can base off of like your previous mixes, you know?
For us, it changes everything. If our sound engineer travels with us, she knows what we want. Yeah, we can't afford to just arrive on stage, and even if we don't have a proper sound check, we know it's going to be okay because she knows us. Yeah, we can just make a move on stage, or a blink an eye, or she understands. So it's we know it's going to be okay.
And do you guys all play? Do you have all in ears, or are you using monitors, or is it a mixture of both?
We started using in ears a year ago, but before that we were using just the monitors in the venues. That was fine for the other members of the band, but with the singing I struggled a lot because small clubs we were playing, I couldn't even hear my vocals when I was singing. Yes, we upgraded to ear monitors, and now it's much better. I can hear myself and I can sing in tune. everything is better now.
No, it's so important to be able to hear yourself as a singer, and so totally understand that. And do you guys use any tracks live, or is it all live? All of you guys just play live? Is there any tracks at all?
Depends. It's like the ear monitors. We used to play 100% live, and the latest gigs, we decided to use my backing vocals from the album as samples on the shows. So sometimes we have more backing vocals added to the shows. It's just backing vocals. But that was when we had our former bass player. And now that we have our new bass player, we don't need my backing vocals anymore. She's singing really well, so she can do it.
Oh, that's great.
That's awesome.
Yeah. But for me, rock and roll is better without any samples or tracks, additional tracks. If we can do it live, it's better.
Totally.
Yeah, I hate playing to track because you don't have that freedom to just go, you know what, we're going to do that bit again. Because then let's just keep going, or it's all locked in, which I hate. Jess, do you hate it being locked in? Or?
The thing is, I play mostly with pop artists and bands, and my band was very pop. So yeah, we actually had started out not playing with tracks because we were very anti-tracks. But the more that we started getting to, I guess, a higher level of gigs, and you know, you kind of have to change.
You can't afford to really to not.
Well, yeah, you kind of, you know, you're playing these big shows. You're like, we kind of do need the filler. And as a drummer, I like having the backing tracks. There's obviously a lot of percussion parts in a lot of our tracks that you can't imitate, you know, do live unless you had all these people playing percussion live.
So true.
So, you know, those little bells and whistles that are nice to have, but not everyone needs it. And in rock and roll, I do agree with Laura. I think it just depends on what you're playing. I mean, with rock and roll, it should be played by just the band, I feel like. That's in my opinion. I think it's very rock and roll to just have no tracks, and you don't really need tracks anyways for it. So
the gigs such as Download Festival, they're obviously huge gigs. How did you get them? Did you have an agent or a manager?
We have a manager here in France. Sometimes he's the one that's asking for the gigs and contacts the venues, and sometimes the bookers and the venues are reaching him to offer a gig. It depends, but I'm not doing anything at the moment. I used to write lots of emails to ask for gigs, but yeah, I haven't been doing doing that for 4 years, I think. Yeah, my manager helped us a lot.
Nice. Yeah. So one other thing that I'm curious about, and all of our listeners who are play guitar or want to get into guitar, what kind of setup, like what guitar do you use? What amp? Who are your like endorsers?
So I've been using Orange amps for as long as I can remember, 8 or 9 years. And I really like how they look on stage. The orange and vintage look is really good. It's good for the band, and the sound is very organic, and it's really what I'm looking for. And my other guitarist in the band is playing Marshall, so we don't have the same sounds, and I think it's good. So we don't use the same frequencies. For the guitars, I'm mostly using Gibson guitars, Gibson Les Paul. My main guitar is Gibson Les Paul Junior that I got last year. It's new, but I love it. It's just simple, just two knobs, one sound. Yeah, a simple and vintage guitar, and that's what I was looking for. That's my
amazing
go-to. Yeah, here.
And how many guitars do you have? I like to ask this because I'm a drummer,
yeah.
And I have like 6 drum kits. So I'm like, how many do you have?
Your drum kits can fit in your house?
Nope, I have to have them in storage because I live in LA and a tiny, tiny, like it's LA. We live in an apartment where there's no way, like the whole apartment would be filled with all my drums if I did that. So.
The same in Paris. It's really expensive. So I have a storage and I think I have 12 or 13 guitars, but we share with the other guitarists in the band. Sometimes we just buy guitars together. So we...
I love that.
We share the guitars. I think I have, yeah, maybe a dozen, but I have like 2 or 3 favorite ones that
wow.
I always use.
Yeah. A dozen guitars. I definitely wasn't expecting that. I'm not going to lie. You definitely topped that with 12.
Yeah, but the most important is I have 2 or 3 important ones and the others.
They're kind of just there to have just in case.
Yeah.
So wait, what are your important ones then, just for our guitarist? Like we won't know, but someone else will.
So Gibson Les Paul Junior, it's a stock one from 2019, a brand new one that Gibson gave me last year when I got the endorsement deal. And before that, I bought a Gibson Les Paul Classic with a Honeyburst top, which is really nice and amazing. That was my dream guitar. That was the first guitar I bought when I got my first paycheck. And the other one I would say would be my Gibson Firebird. I bought from a friend, a used one, and it's really good too. So these are the 3 guitars I mostly use on stage.
Wow, it sounds like you've got a really good setup then.
Yeah, I'm really, really happy about it, and my amps and my pedal board and everything. And a few years ago, I used to be obsessed with gear, and now I'm happy because I don't think about it so much. I feel like I have everything I need and everything I wanted. So just focusing on the music and the important thing and not on gear anymore.
Hey, that's a great feeling, I'm sure. So that's amazing. And obviously huge to have a Gibson endorsement. So that's incredible. But yeah, so the last thing we do, we want to go into a quiz, which don't worry, it's very easy. Everyone gets scared.
We're not going to wreck your birthday.
So please don't hang up on us. We promise this will be nice and easy.
Okay.
Quiz on your birthday. All right, here we go. Question number 1. Dogs or cats?
Dogs, because I don't know. Cats, they don't like me.
Do cats really like anyone? Let's be real.
No, they don't. They actually don't. Our producer's going to be like, no, they do. They definitely do. He loves cats, but no.
I know. My girlfriend loves cats, and she wants us to get a cat, too. And we already have a dog, but I'm like, I don't think our dog wants a cat. But I don't know. Eventually, I'm sure we'll end up with a cat. But right now, I'm like, let's just stick with the dog.
Yeah. All right, second question. Whiskey or vodka?
Beer.
Like, there you go.
Neither.
If I had to choose, it would be vodka because I'm vodka, but I'm a beer girl.
That's fine.
Well, that's very European.
You can write in your own answer. So she writes in beer. All right. Next question. Beach or snow?
Beach. I can't ski. And if I wasn't a guitarist, I would have loved to be a surfer. So. Beach.
Oh, nice. Yes.
All right. Good, good. Good to know.
Yeah. Shout out to our friend Kate, who's a surfer. Next question. Would you prefer to be the headliner or the opener?
I think I'm not sure it's the right answer, but the opener.
No, it is. Some people say that. Yes.
our band, we didn't get so much opportunities to open for our favorite bands, and I wish we could have done that more. Yeah, I would love to open for more of my favorite bands.
Yeah. There's something for definitely in favor of being the opener. We've discussed this many times.
And especially because, yeah, like you said, if you open for like one of your favorite bands, I mean, you just get to watch them every night for free.
Yeah.
So, or get paid to do it.
Yeah, and you don't have that much pressure. You know that people that came into the venue, they're not really here for you. They're so you're just here for fun, and you can play, and you're not playing a really long show, like 30 or 45 minutes. And you know that the audience is not really here for you, so you can't really disappoint them. So
yeah.
Yes, that's true.
Very good point. All right, well then, moving to the last question. What is on your rider?
Beer.
Yeah. I think we would all have fun together. That's fine.
Yeah. Honestly, I don't even know because I wrote that. It's my manager that wrote the writer. But I think, yeah, we asked for IPA beer.
Nice.
We like IPA. Isn't that unusual for a European?
I've met some friends of mine that tells me that French people are more into wine than beer, but I don't know.
Also, IPA is very, like, yes. Australians don't usually like IPA.
Yeah, we don't really have French IPAs, but on our rider, it's not very original. We asking for the gear we want to play on, like Gibson guitars, Marshall and Orange amps, and some good beers. And nothing really pretty original and nothing fancy. But
wow. Well, then you guys are definitely rock and roll. I feel like that's the most rock and roll rider. It's like, just give us the fucking gear to play on and some beer.
That's more rock and roll than we've ever had, actually.
That's amazing. You're definitely in a rock and roll band. For sure. All right. Well, thank you so much. This has been so incredible chatting with you. We really appreciate you taking the time to do this on your birthday.
I know.
Thank you for celebrating with me.
Yes. 25 minutes into the birthday. Yes. Yeah. Thank you so much.
And so for our listeners to be able to find you and follow you maybe on social media, do you want to give us your Instagram handle?
Yeah. On Instagram and Facebook, it's Laura Cox Official. And the website is lauracoxband.com. And YouTube is Laura Cox Official, I think, too. But just Google Laura Cox and you'll find me, I think.
Exactly. It's as easy as that. Just Google her, you'll find it. We'll also tag you when this episode comes out and airs so everyone can follow all the cool stuff you're up to because, yeah, you're incredible. We were watching your videos. You're phenomenal. So everyone out there, definitely, if you haven't yet, check her out. Check her band out. She's very incredible and lovely. And yes, thank you again for doing this on your birthday. Happy birthday. Enjoy the rest of your night.
Thanks a lot. I will.